It's very hard for me not to pick up a stick, not to throw a punch or a kick or a knee or an elbow. I am addicted. If it was something else, they might have an intervention for me.
Hello, everyone. It's episode 102 of Whistlekick Martial Arts Radio, the only place to hear the best stories from the best martial artists, like today's guest, Datu Tim Hartman. At Whistlekick, we make the world's best sparring gear, and here on Martial Arts Radio, we bring you the best martial arts podcast. I'd like to personally welcome you. My name is Jeremy Lesniak. I'm Whistlekick's founder and very fortunate to be your host here on Martial Arts Radio. Thank you to the returning listeners, and hello and welcome to those of you listening for the very first time. If you're new to the show, or you're not familiar with what we make, please check out our sweatshirts. We have some lightweight zip-up ones and some heavier pullovers. Colorful, durable, and they look good. Check them out at whistlekick.com. If you're interested in our sparring gear, which is the heart of what we offer, you can find that there too, or at amazon.com. If you want the show notes, including links and photos, you can find those at whistlekickmartialartsradio.com. If you're not on the newsletter list, now's a great time. We offer exclusive content to subscribers, and it's the only place to find out about upcoming guests for the show. We only email a few times a month. We will never, ever, ever sell or give away your information, and sometimes we mail out a pretty good coupon. So here on episode 102, we hear from a lifelong practitioner of Filipino martial arts, Datu Tim Hartman. Datu Hartman is a legend in the world of FMA, as the collected styles are sometimes referred to. He's a lifelong practitioner of Filipino martial arts, and he's watched the growth of the various disciplines, including arnis, escrima, kali, and the various approaches and styles to these arts. We hear about the man's past, what keeps him inspired to train, and why he's still so passionate, not only about martial arts in general, but about passing on what he's learned to newer students. Let's welcome him to the show. Datu Hartman, welcome to Whistlekick Martial Arts Radio.
Thank you.
It's a pleasure to have you here, and I appreciate your time, and looking forward to learning more about you, as I'm sure all of the listeners will be as well.
Okay.
So let's start the way we always start, the best way to start. How did you get started in the martial arts?
It was an interesting thing. When I was two, I used to watch Kung Fu, the series with my father, the original series. And I used to go around the neighborhood playing martial arts, or otherwise known as beating up all the other two-year-olds. Obviously, that didn't go over too well. And then we, after that correction and attitude, of course, what does a two-year-old know? It was in 1980, a bunch of my friends were doing martial arts. So I was working out with them in their backyard. So I was just doing a lot of backyard, basement type workouts, throughout high school. And then when I was 19, which would be 94, 95, I decided it's time for me to get serious. And there was a karate school around the corner. I had planned on going there, but I wanted to look around first. And just as I was about to figure out that the school around the corner was the one for me, a friend of mine called me up and said, "Hey, you got to check this place out." And so I hopped in. And it was the Filipino Karate Academy. And day one, I walked in, they put a stick in my hand, and I fell in love.
So that's a little bit different than what I'm sure most of our listeners, and certainly different from what I'm used to, in a lot of systems. Weapons are not the first thing that we start with, right? We start with empty hand. And of course, we've had a couple Filipino martial art practitioners on the show, and they've talked to us about that difference a little bit. Yeah. So what was it like for you stepping out there and, I'm going to guess, being exposed to something a little bit different than what you would have expected? Most of us are, even before we start in martial arts, we expect martial arts is going to be more about punching and kicking than weapons, and here they put a stick in your hand day one. What was that like for you?
Oh, I was in heaven because I had a huge weapon collection.
Okay, so you were a step ahead already.
I was that guy. I had nunchucks, I had stabs, I had knives, all laying around the house. And, you know, and as far as my, so the art was modern arnis. So, which the founder was the late Grandmaster Remy Praises. And to my knowledge, he was a silent partner in this club. And so for me, I fell in love. As far as my open hand combatives, I had pretty much taught myself or worked out with my friends all my striking long before I ever hopped in. So I wasn't necessarily good at striking. But I was efficient. I was the new kid in the neighborhood and I had to prove myself a lot. So, you know, I honed my skills or get some basic skills that way, protecting myself. And then when, and all my friends did open hand stuff. So when I finally got into this school and they threw a stick in my hand, I was as giddy as a schoolgirl, you know, and, the issue, or the thing that was different as with what we do, though, is modern arnis is actually 50-50 open hand and weapon. So we would do the stick technique, and then we would do the open hand interpretation of it. So it was more of a prop to teach open hand combatives. So, you know, some Filipino, I do more than one Filipino style. And some of them, it's all weapon all the time. But the nice thing about Professor Praises' arnis system was that it was meant to be done all different ways. So armed, you know, using a weapon to execute maneuvers. Unarmed, your assailant has a weapon and you don't. And then mano-mano, where neither of you do have a weapon. So it's a complete system. So it is. So I would say it's more 50-50 training the open-hand combatives all the way up. So,
but I'm wondering, you know, you're talking about the experience, the self-taught and self-developed experience of your open hand techniques. I'm wondering how it would have gone for you if you had stepped into a more traditional, I shouldn't say more traditional, a more empty hand focused martial arts school. You know, would you have had that same passion right away?
Oh, I don't think so. I mean, I love martial arts. Don't get me wrong. I mean, I love, so people ask me what I do and what my hobbies are. Well, what I do is Filipino martial arts. What my hobbies are other martial arts.
Okay.
You know, I mean, there's other things I do too, but I mean, in my training, I have played with, and I don't want to sit there and say I studied, because a lot of times people misinterpret or choose to misinterpret or mislead people unintentionally or intentionally, but I've attended a lot of different seminars and visited a lot of different schools just to try things, you know, the martial buffet, you know. And I've done jujitsu, ninjutsu, taekwondo, all different forms of karate, different forms of Filipino martial arts, aikido, kempo. You know, it came into town for a seminar and I had the time off. I tried to see it. Someone I met at a tournament, you should stop down by my school sometime. Well, I was knocking on the door 2 to 3 days later. You know, I just, I was a sponge. I wanted to do everything. And as far as where I would have ended up if I had started an open hand program, I still probably would be doing stuff, but I don't think I would have found my niche per se. I think I'd be a lifer like I am now, but I might be still searching, or, you know, I probably would have found it, but it would have been longer. And then I might have another martial DNA blended in there, you know. And what I like is that when I'm around out and about doing martial arts and people start talking about what they've done, I haven't found many people that started in Filipino martial arts. Even a lot of the masters over here in the States, and even some from the Philippines, you know, a lot of them started in karate or taekwondo and then switched over. And, you know, it's a different mindset. I move differently than a lot of people because of the fact that I'm not, I cross train out of Filipino martial arts. I don't cross train into Filipino martial arts. You know, when you cross train, you're always going to have that martial DNA. You know, I'm doing Brazilian jiu-jitsu. You know, I'm always doing something as a stick fighter. I'm always thinking about where's the knife, where's the stick, how do I incorporate things? I do pretty good with my jiu-jitsu, but at the end of the day, I'm still a Filipino martial artist, and that'll come out during that stuff.
That's really an interesting thing to think about. And it's not something I think we've talked about much, maybe not even at all on the show, the idea that the first martial art that you start in will carry through and influence everything else that you do because of, as you've put it, it's your martial art DNA.
Yeah.
It's your first connection to that realm.
Well, so let's go through the systems I do so I can refer back and forth so I'm just not whipping off things. So I started in modern arnis. And I'm only going to talk about the things that I have certification in.
Okay.
So I have modern arnis. I do balintwak, which there's no certification in that, but I was brought in by my teacher, the late Grand Master Remy Praises, to Manong Ted Buat, who used to teach ranch on Bacan in Cebu. I've got the modern, the balintwak kombatan, which is a derivative of modern arnis that was formed by Remy's younger brother Ernesto. I am certified in Dikiti Tertia under Nene Tortal. I'm actually pulling up my resume on my phone because I don't recall.
it's that long that you have trouble remembering. That is an impressive martial art.
No, too many sticks to the head. okay, here we go. So we do modern arnis and kombatan, the Bacan Buat lineage of balintwak. I do Dikiti Tertia. Well, I've certified Dikiti Tertia. I am a first degree black belt in Kuntao with a W, a black belt in Sikaran. Those are both Filipino open hand systems. Under Dr. Manong G, I am a master instructor of Bondo stick fighting, and I am working on my blue belt in Brazilian Jiu Jitsu. So I've got a few stripes towards that. I've done other things, and there's actually some systems that I've trained. I don't even claim them anymore because I haven't logged in enough hours to maintain my training. Now as we're getting back, we're talking about how I do things. So the Kung Tao is an open hand karate kung fu system from the Philippines. So when I do that, I went up the ranks fairly fast. It was 3 years. I was doing hourly private training monthly up in Toronto, which is about 2 hours from me. So it was like 2 hours of training, but it was a 4 hour round trip. While I graduated with another person for their black belts, I could do the art. I earned it, but I would always tell anyone, if you want to look at the way the art's done, don't look at me per se, because I have other martial DNA hardwired into me. And I can do it. I can pass the test, but I'm not necessarily the best representative of that system.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
That makes sense. Cool. So that gives us a lot of context for who you are. And as you said, very few people started in Filipino martial arts. They ended up going to it. And just kind of a fun aside, the few people that I know that ended up in Filipino martial arts, they were destined for it. I mean, it is the thing that resonates with them more than any other style. And they're so incredibly passionate about it. And it's an art that I've been interested in learning more about and enjoying having folks like yourself on, so I can get more of an education about it. And, I've been dabbling when I have the opportunity, just as you're talking about with seminars and whatnot.
Yeah. Okay. Great.
But as you've traveled around and everything, I'm sure you've acquired a great number of stories, which is kind of the DNA of this show. And I'm wondering if you might share with us one of your best martial arts stories.
Oh, best martial arts story. Well, I'm trying to think what a good, I mean, I've got a lot of stories, but I don't know how many are, that's a rough question, because there's, like I said, there's a lot of things, a lot of different things. Well, you know what? I can give you one off the bat, maybe another one will pop in later during the interview. It's funny in how small the world can be. How's that?
Okay.
So Professor Prasis was the founder of Modern Arnis, was on the cover of Black Belt magazine more than once. Really, the guy in his era was probably the guy who's done more for Filipino martial arts than anyone else. Was a goodwill ambassador for the Philippines with diplomatic papers. And that helped get a lot of people involved, including Guru Inasano. Okay. And so he's teaching in Germany. I'm with him, helping teach along with a couple of Americans. And we go out afterwards for food at this Chinese restaurant. And all of a sudden, a guy walks in with a crew, Asian gentleman. I'm like, okay, that sticks out. We're in Germany. I look, I go, I know who this guy is. I nod to him, he nods me, goes in the back. And then I said, like, we know that guy. And everyone's like, well, who are you talking about? That Asian guy. Well, who is that? And I start whipping off all the movies he's been in, or the movie he's been in. I can't remember his name. It was Eric Lee. And I say, yo, Weapons of Death. It was a really cool cult movie. And so that's Eric Lee. Yeah. So we go, I go, let me go back. And Professor, no. I will go, you know, talk to him. So he goes into the back room and he disappears for about 10 minutes. We're like, all right, I think it's time to send out a search party. Well, here comes Professor with Eric Lee and his crew. He goes, this is Eric Lee, he introduces everybody. And I'm like, yeah, I remember for the movies. They go, yeah. And the German host for him goes, oh my goodness, I think that's Remy Prasis when they walk by us. So it's just kind of fun. And then, you know, he hung out for the rest of the weekend with us and stuff. So it's kind of cool how two American citizens, because by then Professor was a naturalized American citizen, both happened to be in Hamburg, Germany, in the same restaurant at the same time. And it's just kind of cool how the world just keeps getting smaller and smaller and smaller.
Yeah, one of the things that a lot of the guests on this show have talked about is that the martial arts, once you get to the point of traveling, you know, of course, there are a ton of people that train in their schools and maybe go to some local events. But once you start traveling around, it doesn't even have to be internationally, but just regionally, the number of people you bump into and the number of degrees of separation, it's nowhere near six. It might be two.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a lot of fun. I love stories like that, and I appreciate you sharing that.
Yeah. It'll probably spark something because, you know, once again, when someone asks me about a story, it's kind of hard just to – a lot of times my stories are all relevant to what's going on at the moment. If it's a technique or tell me about this guy or, you know, tell me about when you were teaching in the Philippines or in Europe or, you know, fill in the blank, I can, you know, talk about different things like that. But it's, you know, just, you know, stories on demand kind of, you know, it's like which one to choose from.
Sure. No, I understand. And as we get going, you know, as stories pop into your head, by all means, please share them with us.
Okay.
So let's go back and let's go down a hypothetical road. Okay. Let's pretend that you never end up in some kind of formal martial arts training. You've got your collection of weapons around your house and you've got the open hand techniques that you've developed on your own through working with your friends and a bit of necessity, but never any real formal training.
Okay.
What do you think your life would look like today?
Boring.
Okay.
You know, I probably would be getting myself in a lot more trouble. You know, martial arts has definitely been a calming influence, an avenue for to release a lot of energy. I don't know. I mean, I was going down in school. One of the things I was trying to do was go down to performing arts. So I was a singer and an actor. And we were thinking about getting more serious into that. And then I did a couple left turns here, there, and everywhere. And martial arts just kept taking more and more of my time. But, you know, I'd probably have a 9-to-5 type job. You know, I was, while I was doing this, when I graduated from high school, I went right into the workforce. And I was working for Pizza Hut for a little while, then Advance Auto Parts. And I used to train a lot of the managers coming in how to use the computer systems and stuff. So I was a shift manager. So I'd probably be hiring that company. Nothing wrong. Nothing I didn't enjoy, but I don't think anything with the passion that I have for my martial arts.
And that was the word that kind of came to mind as I listened to your description. And I think, you know, we're not even terribly far into our conversation yet. And one of the things that hit me as soon as we started talking, even before we started recording, was it's very clear that you are passionate about martial arts. And just that little detour there, the passion fell out of your words. You know, you strike me as someone who probably works hard and has a strong work ethic, but it's clear that you would have been a very unfulfilled individual had you continued down that path and not focused on martial arts.
Yeah. Who knows where I would have been. I had a lot of different hobbies that I really enjoyed. I just don't know, you know, just it's hard. I can't think of life without it. I mean, I can't sit at my couch without having something in my hand. So sometimes it's a training knife, a real knife, a stick, a sword. I've had more than one occasion, women in my life, threaten to hit me if I hit them with my stick as I'm practicing here. I can't think of a day when I don't do martial arts one way or another. And when people say, what do you do on vacation? I don't go on vacation. I go on martial art trips because I could write the vacation off.
Right.
You know, but I don't remember. Okay. So a big part of my business is teaching seminars. I'm only home about 15 weekends out of the year. Now I'm home during the week. It's just the weekends, you know, the weekday I pack up, Friday I leave, maybe Thursday, do seminars, come back Sunday or Monday, unload, wash laundry, repeat everything over again. So when I'm in town, unless I've been sick, I can't think of a day that I haven't set foot in my school. You know, I got to come here. I just cannot not be here. Maybe I hit the bag a little. I make sure my computer is in the school. So I make sure I get up and move as opposed to having an office at home like I used to. And, you know, some days it was late in the afternoon and I hadn't done anything, you know. Get out of bed, throw the bathrobe on, quiet. I've got one of my sick dogs with me, so excuse me, the people who are listening.
Sure, no worries.
Get over here. So it's very hard for me not to come in the building and do something. It's very hard for me not to pick up a stick, not to throw a punch or a kick or a knee or an elbow or do some hand combination or visualize a wrist lock I am addicted. I mean, if it was something else, they might have an intervention for me.
I feel like there's a t-shirt slogan there somewhere.
There's gotta be something going on. The intervention, I can take most of the people who might be trying to do.
And that's probably why there are martial arts interventions, right?
There you go.
I think, you know, maybe we can reach out to Master Ken. It sounds like that would be a great episode of Enter the Dojo.
He did the ninjutsu intervention, so, you know.
Yeah.
He's a Kempo guy, too.
He is originally an Okinawan guy. We've had him on the show.
Really? Oh, yeah.
In super fun example of how small the martial arts world is, we're mid-episode and realize that we grew up 45 minutes away from each other and know a ton of the same people.
That's cool. That's cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, I used to help co-run. I was one of the co-founders of Martial Talk.
Oh, okay.
And I run FMA Talk, Martial Talk has changed hands, but it was Bob Hubbard and myself were the two that started it off. And, you know, it started off with arnis, then Kempo Karate, and then it just got bigger than both of us. So, he used to be on our forum. He used to also be on Kempo Talk forum, which is another spinoff. So, yeah, and he was a funny guy. Very talented. I can't believe how well he can keep a straight face.
it is incredible. And even if you don't listen to the entire interview, I would encourage all of the listeners to go back, and I'll link it in the show notes, martial arts, whistlekickmartialartsradio.com. But I'll link to that episode. I forget what one it is somewhere.
Is he in character, or 40s. Is he...
We did the first, and it took us a while to set this up. We did the first, I want to say 10, 15 minutes in character.
Okay, that's cool.
And I had a different microphone set up at the time that allowed me to mute it very easily and quietly. And of that 15 minutes, I was probably muted 13 minutes because I was laughing hysterically and just to not break in. And he does a phenomenal job.
He's amazing. I've seen footage from the Maya shows, and, you know, busting like Bill Wallace's chops and face to face. And
yeah, he's a riot. Absolute riot. All right, so let's pull it back. You know, it's pretty clear that your life would have at least been boring if somehow we had broken that destiny that was you ending up in not just martial arts, but Filipino martial arts. And let's think about a low point, a tough time. And how did your martial arts training help you move past that?
Well, it's given me an outlet. Something to focus on that can positively help me. I have lost a fair amount of my family over the years. And through that time, this is something that I could do on my own. I don't have to worry about playing well with others. I'm not going to get all zen, because I'm actually from a blue collar town, you know, and the area that I grew up in, we're a little rough around the edges, and so I don't get all philosophical to that extent. For me, it was just a nice positive outlet that I could come in, do some training on my own, get off a lot of energy, and focus on things, when you lose a family member, it's rough, and you don't want to ignore it, but you got to do something to, you don't want to just sit around and just dwell on that, because no matter what you do, I'm a little cold when it comes to people passing because of how many people in my family have passed on in the years, but at the end of the day, there's nothing I can do about it. It happened. We learned from the lessons of how they lived and how they passed on. And sometimes when they pass on, it's a good, bad thing, and I just need to focus on something. The martial arts has always been there for me. So, I can do something else. It's like, all right, just like getting knocked on your butt when you're sparring. Doesn't matter how many times you're knocked down, it's about how many times you get up. We've heard that over and over again. And, we've gotten way too PC. It's not like time for everyone to man and woman up, brush themselves off, and get on with their life, And martial arts has been a good venue for me to do that.
I would agree wholeheartedly. But we'll leave that there because
that's another can of worms.
That's a can of worms that I'm sure you and I would be good to go on. But of course,
I'm kind of becoming the Dennis Leary of the martial art world. I'm like Master, a little similar to Master Ken, but a little different. Recently, there's been, life annoys me. Life is, I'm sad, I'm depressed, and it's not because I'm. And I think we're all over-diagnosed, over-medicated, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. But, I see what's happening in the world, and it makes me sad. I'm depressed. I mean, you know, I grew up in an era that seemed to be much nicer, much happier. And it's, you know, I'm depressed as in, you know, this makes me sad. I'm not depressed as in I need to be medicated, you know, and I realize that I have to start saying what I mean, which I always have, but sometimes not mixing words. That doesn't mean we have to be mean when we do this, but sometimes we have to get in someone's face and call it the way you see it a little more abruptly, because sometimes people can't read between the lines. You know, whether you like Donald Trump or not, you know what he's thinking. You know, there's no mixed message when he says something to someone. And I don't get involved with politics, and I'm not going to, obviously, we don't want this show to get that way.
But, thank you.
I think the one thing I like about Donald Trump is that he's not afraid to speak his mind. Now, of course, he's got more money than anyone else out there, so he can afford to do whatever he wants. But still, nonetheless, it's, I think too many people out there are afraid to say things and just call it the way you see it. You know, I was talking about to someone the other day about some stuff that's going on in the martial art world, and I'm saying, well, I'm trying to get information on this person. And they said, and I was talking to this guy, and I was told that he said something. And I called him up about it. No. There must be some misunderstanding. Or the other person's lying. Well, you could say that. I go, I just did. Okay. And I'm not trying to call him a liar. I'm just saying maybe the guy's lying. Maybe he isn't. I don't know. I'm trying to get to the bottom of things. And, you know, otherwise, people are always saying, well, there could be some kind of miscommunication, yada, yada, yada. And it's like, no, let's call what we think it is. And if we're wrong, then we'll apologize for being wrong later. You know, like I said, we don't have to be nasty, but we can be honest.
Right. One of the life, lessons, rules, I guess, that I've come to over the last year or so has been, I don't say anything about anyone that I wouldn't say if they weren't in the room.
And as I tell people things, they go, why would you tell this person? They might tell someone else. And I'm like, exactly. I'm not telling anyone that I wouldn't want out there. You know,
some of us certainly have a wider amount that we're willing to say to others. But there's a lot of integrity in that, in being willing to speak your mind. And it's something that I hope listeners are willing to consider, maybe not a direct martial arts lesson, but certainly something that I think those of us that have been training can appreciate the importance of it.
You know, there's only one way to keep a secret, and that's tell no one. So every time I talk to someone, you know, I go with the mentality that whatever I said is going to get out there. So, you know, make sure that whatever you say, you know, is not going to embarrass you. You know, you could be direct and still be pleasant about things. You don't have to be cruel. You can sit there and say, hey, I don't know about this. Can you tell me about X, Y, and Z? Or I don't like this, but that doesn't mean you can't change my mind, you know, and I think this, that, and that, but guess what? You have a valid point as well.
Right. Honesty and respect are separate and can go together. Yeah. So let's talk about some of your influences. You've mentioned a few names, and certainly we get a sense of who's important to you with your Filipino martial arts lineage. But if we were to take a couple of those out, the really core people that helped, quote unquote, raise you, who would you say has been the most influential person in your upbringing?
So if we're not talking about my direct instructors?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I would say the person that, there's a couple people, I would say Hiroki Kimura.
Okay.
He owned S&P Budo Martial Arts Supplies. He taught, he was teaching Goshin Kenpo. He was here in the Buffalo area. He had the first real martial arts supply company in the area. That was the only two, really. It was him and this other place, Pachillo's. So I would visit him after work. I had left my instructor, initial instructor. John Bryant was my first arnis instructor. He was getting out of the town. just, you know, changing a life. Some things were happening in the club. I just decided that, I just did my own thing. And I left, and then Grandmaster Price has called me up and said, if you want to continue, I'll take you on as a private student, which I thought was great. Well, the problem is that I didn't have a day-to-day instructor. So I would see Remy, and then I would train all on my own. So Mr. Kimura, which I would visit probably twice a week, you know, because he was right down the road from work, we would talk about things in martial arts, and he actually helped me develop my martial moral compass. You know, he's actually teaching in my school now, shut down the business a couple of years ago, wanted to slow things down, and he's here two nights a week. And, he's like, we talk about this all the time. He's like, I don't recall that. I go, Kimura-san, how many times did I come visit you? Oh, at least twice a week. And how long did we talk? At least an hour or two, and I was learning from you the whole time, every time you talked to me and we talked about stories and all this other stuff, I listened and I took them to heart, he was very instrumental. I would say a group of people who helped out were the Parker Kempo people. And what happened is I heard rumors that Filipinos in Hawaii used to use Kempo as a vehicle to teach their Filipino martial arts. So there was a Kempo guy here locally. He was teaching at my school for a while. He goes, hey, you gotta check these seminars out. They're a pretty good time. So I went down to Philly and I met all these people. It was hosted by Mike Cappy. But then I got to meet, Paul Dye, Huck Polanis, Lee Wedlake, Ron Chappelle. The list just kept going. Bob White, and the list just kept going and going and going, and, and including Ed Parker Jr. And, I talked to Edmund a lot because, it was his father who passed, and he gave me some. He actually did our diplomas for our organization and did a couple portraits for us. And then I spent a lot of time with Huck Polanis. And, these guys, when I would talk to them, they would tell me, they had went through this with Mr. Parker, went through all this. So, they would say, hey, Tim, this, and this is going to happen. I go, yep, that did. All right, well, now this is going to happen next. And, they were right on the money, exactly how things were going to go down. So they helped me on a couple things, one of which was, how to ride the wave after Professor's passing. And the other was developing a language. They had examples of them with their system, because in Filipino martial arts, a lot of time it's just, oh, just do this, do that, do the other thing, yada, yada, yada. Nothing had a name. And, and maybe it's my German ancestry, but I needed to have some structure there. And they helped me view on how, using the Kempo terminology and understanding it, it helped me learn how to develop my own terminology. And some of the terms cross over, because I teach a lot of Kempo people at events. So I want to always be familiar with their terminology so I can relate, but I would say they were very, the Kempo people were very, very nice to me. They brought me in as family, and they were very good mentors how to deal with, what happens when your teacher passes on and when your teacher was the head of the system. So it would be Hiroki Kimura and all my martial art brothers and sisters in the Kempo world helped out.
Great. Yeah, some good stuff coming out of that world, both of those worlds. Absolutely. And got a good sense for the reverence of the first gentleman you mentioned. Name, I didn't jot his name.
Hiroki Kimura.
Hiroki Kimura, yeah. Could really sense the respect that you have for him as you started talking about him. So let's talk about competition. Has that ever been a thread through your career?
Oh, yeah. We're not really doing much at the moment, but I and my students, you know, we went out, we have a team, Datu's Tribe. So my title is Datu. That's a tribal leader. So when we were coming up with the name of the team, it's like, well, I'm the Datu, you're my tribe. How about we go with Datu's Tribe? And everyone thought that was cool. Actually, some of the teams on the circuit were upset because they really, like, that's really the coolest name I've ever heard, because it's like, you know, accurate. And I go, yeah. And then, of course, when Survivor's on, I go, yeah, when we have tribal council, I always have immunity. So they all chuckle at that and stuff. But, you know, we've competed. I've hosted events. We've competed events. We've done a lot of the open martial arts stuff. So we're doing sport karate. We've developed, I've developed champions in here, you know, local, regional, national, international champions. I myself have won three world titles. My students are better than me now, you know, when it comes to that. I've gone more in the focusing on the coaching aspect. Two of my guys have done the cage stick fighting, so think MMA fighting with rattan sticks. So we've got two champions through SFW, which is Stick Fighting World. You know, I think it's a you know, the competition is good. At times, and then there's those other times. You know, I think martial arts develops character. Martial sports reveals character, and it's interesting to see how some people are in that sport world. And people I thought were really good people turn out to be very big jerks. And then some people I thought were idiots turn out to be really nice guys, really, you know, very sportsmanlike and stuff. And, you know, just, you know, it's an eye-opening experience, you know. You know, there's martial art, there's martial sport, there's martial combat. Some of our material can be used in all three. Others are specifically for those areas. And, you know, I guess the thing is, depends on what you want your focal point to be, you know. We do all of that in certain portions or proportions. You know, right now we've backed away from the sport. Just, you know, I'm doing a lot of seminars now, so it's hard to maintain, you know, go pay to compete somewhere versus go and be paid to teach, you know. And after the recession, things definitely changed for a lot of people, you know, financially. So, but, you know, we've done it. Like I said, I've probably had 15 world titles come through our school, you know, but we've stripped a lot of that stuff down, getting rid of all the trophies and medals hanging around the club. It's just clutter, you know, and people are just looking for good martial arts these days. You know, when people are looking for competition, if the ones that think they want to do MMA, then they go to the club and they realize it's a great workout, and then they get one fight and then they never fight again, but they still can train, you know.
Sure.
You know, I mean, that goes with everything. You know, a lot of my students come in, let's do a tournament. They do one. They said, okay, I've had enough. Great. You know, and just, you know, I mean, because, you know, so you get some people who just, you know, I want to find tournaments that are like house league stuff where it's just a good learning experience. And there's too many people out there that, you know, they get all obsessed about it. And it's like, yeah, I understand. When you're spending all that money, you want to make sure that all the rules are followed and all this other stuff. But at the end of the day, I mean, I know people that have spent easily 15 grand in a year competing. And I'm like, what does that get you? I mean, if you enjoy it, more power to you. But, you know, it's not getting you anything major these days. You know, I mean, it's not. I don't know of a lot of tournament champions who are getting movie deals or, you know, doing a seminar tour afterwards. And, you know, because at the end of the day, I don't want the guy who's the champ. I want the guy who coached him. You know,
right.
You know, I get all these advertisements for USC champions to come visit my school and teach. I'm like, no, guest appearance, maybe, But I want the guy who coached him. I mean, most of these fighters, it's hard to find a fighter that knows how to teach because they're being coached to fight. You know, they don't have the experience. Not to say they can't be good at it. It's just that's not their primary thing. So, you know, but
doing and teaching are two very different skill sets.
Huge different skill sets. So, you know, and I was a very good doer. And I had the knack for teaching, but it took me a long time to hone the craft to get to where I am today. And, you know, part of the problem was the system I do, Filipino martial arts. There's no instruction manual. There's no terminology. There's none of that stuff, you know. So, you know, I have to invent it all or, you know, develop it all for myself. You know, I have to rethink of it. Is that the proper word? Rethink about it again. No, let's do it a different here and go from there. So.
Okay. Yeah, I agree with everything that you're saying. I think there's a lot of value in competition, but I think that there comes a point where there's a diminishing rate of return on that value, and that once you cross that threshold, unless you're doing it for the love of doing it, you're probably not going to get a lot back.
You know, if my students go to a tournament, they like seeing the old man getting out there with them. So I don't mind being in the trenches with my people. You know, the world championships are for the world Sikaron, which is Filipino foot fighting. It's like Taekwondo. Well, if you watch the art, it doesn't look like Taekwondo. When you watch the sport application, it looks a lot like Taekwondo. Okay. And the world gatherings next year, March 2017, for Grandmaster Geronimo's birthday. So they're doing this will be the third world tournament that goes with it. And I was up in Canada in Manitoba, and they do other divisions, so they'll do stick, knife, open hand kata, the whole nine yards. So I actually won. I got gold in my in single stick sparring and in knife sparring. And obviously, it's a padded knife. who's going to insure the other one? You know, but. So I earned two, you know, I actually competed in those two divisions in kata and then weapons forms, and I medaled in everything, but I got two golds, and I'd be defending my title if I go back. I'm going to the event. I'm just not sure if I'm planning on competing or not. I'll be 52 at the time, and I got to say, when I competed, there was a lot of, I don't know of anyone that was below a fourth degree black belt in my division. There had to be 15 people there. So I was excited, you know. I was like, all right, you know, this is a division that's really the master's division, not just in age, but in experience. So it was really cool. It was really cool.
And granted, it's just anecdotal, but you know, at Whistlekick, we set up a booth at quite a few martial arts events, and over the last couple of years that we've been doing this, it seems like there's a little bit more experience creeping into the adult black belt division. So that's nice to see that, you know, just as yourself, you know, you've realized your students like to see what you can do. It gives them something to strive for. And personally, I'm just seeing more of that. I hope it continues because it's what makes everyone better.
Well, we got to lead by example so people can follow by choice.
I like that. I've heard that. Of course, we've heard the first half. I don't know that I've heard the second half. That's pretty poignant. So let's talk about things that maybe could have been. If you could train with anybody that you haven't, be they alive or dead, who would you want to work out with and why?
That's a really good question. I've been trying to think about that one when you sent me the list here. And, you know, I've been very fortunate to train with a lot of people. The people I would be looking for probably the late Edgar Salute. He was an up-and-comer in the Filipino martial arts world. Grandmaster Sawanda. Didn't get a chance to train with Larry Hartzell. Ted Luque would be another one. most of them, they fall in the category of a Filipino martial art, or like the JKD with the Filipino concepts blended in with it. But mm-hmm. I don't exclude others. I got to see some people, but I didn't get to train them. Like Taiko Yada, he was pretty amazing, you know. But I learned more by watching him on the sidelines than I would have on the mat, because he's very, I don't want to say he's stingy. He was about focusing on making one technique as good as you can. So it was time consuming, and you wouldn't get a quantity as opposed to you'd get a quality of material. But unfortunately, I'm not a forms driven system for most of my style. So a lot of that wouldn't necessarily directly translate to my day-to-day training. But, right off the top of my head, that would be those three names right there. You know, Larry Hartzell, Teddy Luque, Edgar Salute. I know, Swandes, yeah. GM Swandes, Herman Swandes. So, that would be probably it. You could probably whip off some names and go, oh yeah. You know what I mean? My thing was, I wanted to see everybody. So I'll give an example. I was at the first or second NATMA convention down in Clearwater, Florida. So I'm talking to some people like, what class are you doing next? Oh, I'm going to do the retention class, and I'm going to do the intro class. You know, it's a business seminar weekend. And I go, Tim, what are you doing? Oh, I'm taking the class with Fumio Demura. Isn't that the karate guy? That's the karate guy. Yeah. You do Filipino martial arts? Yeah. What are you learning from him? I don't give a damn. It's Fumio Demura. And there's a picture. The magazine came out later, and there's me sitting in the front row looking up at Fumio Demura as a little school kid looking, you know, ooh, wow, because I knew who Fumio Demura was. And, you know, I'm just all in. I mean, I will go see anything. Now, you know, in all sincerity, the seminar was nothing. I didn't enjoy it at all because it wasn't applicable to what I'm doing. But it was Fumio Demura. And I had a blast because I got to train with Fumio Demura, you know, the unofficial bucket list, you know. And, you know, I don't have an official bucket list of people I want to work with. It's just anybody I get a chance to see, I want a piece of them, you know. And, you know, so what's that? So,
but that's quite a list.
Yeah.
And it's a great list.
Yeah.
And I can certainly empathize with that idea that training with everyone. I mean, you kind of talked about that earlier on in our conversation that, you know, if somebody opened the door to you, you'd be there in 2 to 3 days. And I'm the same way. And I think a lot of our listeners are too. They, you know, passionate about the martial arts, not a martial art singular.
You know, actually, here's the person I'd really want to train with, and not for the reason everyone's going to think it's going to be. It would be Bruce Lee.
Okay.
Now, I was a big Bruce Lee fan when I was a kid, and I'm not saying I'm not a Bruce Lee fan, but he didn't even get a chance to get good. Can you imagine how good he would be today?
Yeah.
I would love to see where he was back then prior to this. You know, film you couldn't trust, not to say that they edited it. The technology couldn't capture speed properly. So, and he died in his 30s. Man, that's a newborn in martial arts. That's a baby in martial arts. You know, in the martial art world, I mean, you know, I just turned 51 this year. I consider myself middle-aged in the real world. But I also consider myself, that's middle age in the, I might have hit adulthood now in the martial art world, you know. And I mean, if he, it would be interesting to see where he would be now. I mean, I think he'd be doing a lot. He would have been doing movies the whole time. Because I don't think Under the Dragon was big because he passed. That movie stands the test of time.
Without a doubt.
But I would really love to see where he was back then in person, crossing hands. And then, he was ahead of his time, but without proper forms of grading, you know, you don't have anything to really tell you how our perception of things is a lot different. Like, you watch old movies, like I was watching James Bond with Sean Connery. And when I first saw it, I was like, yeah, those are good fight scenes. Now I'm like cringing left and right. So I'd like to see what he looked like back then in person. And then, you know, also to be able to judge how much martial arts evolved since then. Have we caught up to him? Have we surpassed him? I think we probably have surpassed him as a whole, as a community, not necessarily as an individual. You know, he was a Wayne Gretzky or a Michael Jordan of martial arts in that era. You know, well, right. Where would they be today, you know?
Right. I agree. And that's a really interesting idea. And what's coming to mind for me is the fact that Bruce Lee was so cerebral in his approach and, you know, was constantly evolving things. We did an episode with someone who trained at the Oakland school that Bruce Lee started. And, you know, we got to hear what it was like to have Bruce Lee phone in, and because he was doing so much travel, phone in and say, here's an adjustment to the curriculum.
Cool.
You know, living through that Jeet Kune Do formation, really. And I don't expect that that's something that would ever get switched off, that mental component. So I think you're right. Where would he have taken it if he had, you know, lived and trained through 60, 70, 80 years old?
Yeah, exactly.
So let's lighten it up a little bit. Go to some media questions. Okay. Martial arts movies. We talked about Enter the Dragon. You mentioned Weapons of Death and your love for the movie, for the TV show, rather, Kung Fu. Do you have a favorite martial arts movie, or did we just name?
No. Well, there's a couple. You know, I think movie-wise, my whole comment about movies that have stood the test of time, at least American-based movies or movies with Americans in it, would be Enter the Dragon and Karate Kid. With Ralph Macchio. You look at the eras that they were filmed, their stuff still looks good technique-wise. I'm a big Karate Kid fan because how much it did for the for us as an industry. You know, but let's see, my favorite movies, it'd have to be plural. I like Five Deadly Venoms. Big fan of that. Love the Shaw Brothers. Kid with the Golden Arm. I'm trying to track that one down. Haven't seen that in a while. That was the movies I used to watch on Kung Fu Cinema when I was a kid. If we're talking more current, I like the Ip Man series a lot. I haven't seen the last one with Tyson in it, but the first two were amazing. You know. And see, and it's rough because a lot of martial arts movies have fallen in the genre of action movies. Right. So it's hard. I like Fearless and Unleashed with Jet Li. I was a big fan of The Protector with Jackie Chan growing up. I mean, there's just a lot of good movies out there. It just, you know, it depends, you know, like a lot of the stuff I'd say now has fallen into with the crossover genre. I think it was Van Damme who really started those crossovers. You know, when he did Bloodsport and Kickboxer were martial art movies. And then once he did Universal Soldier with Dolph Lundgren, the two of them crossed over into action, being action stars versus a martial artist. So, there's a lot of movies that in that category. I at the time I enjoyed Above the Law with Seagal. You know, but a lot of these I haven't watched lately, so I don't know if I'd still enjoy them. You know, I mean, some of those things. You know, anytime I put on Enter the Dragon, I always enjoy that. Karate Kid, I always enjoy it. Some of the movies I've looked back on, you know, I was a little afraid when I, Netflix had Five Deadly Venoms. So I ordered my copy of it, got it in, and I'm like, okay, I was happy. You know, obviously the storyline was could have been better, but I was watching it for the martial arts.
Right.
My friend moved to Thailand for a while teaching, and he sends me the video. I don't know if you've seen the movie Chocolate.
I haven't.
It's an autistic girl who loves chocolate and learns martial arts and dreams or something
like that. Somebody was talking about that on the show recently. I don't even know if that episode's come out yet.
Yeah. Gave me the app thing and I watched it. I couldn't watch like 10 minutes. I had to shut off. Like, Eric, what are you doing to me here? Oh, the fight scenes are amazing. Like, you've been in Thailand way too long, my friend. Because maybe the fight scenes were cool, but I couldn't get past the acting. My taste has matured over the years.
You know, it's interesting, as you were talking about Enter the Dragon and Karate Kid and some of these others and your phrase, standing the test of time, the thing that I'm noticing as a common thread is the caliber of martial artists that were involved on the back end. And we've talked about the Karate Kid and the involvement of Fumio Demura behind the scenes on that movie. I don't know if you're aware of that.
Oh, I didn't know. Oh, he stood in for Miyagi, right?
He did stunt stuff and he did choreography. And in fact, Pat Morita spent so much time with Fumio Demura that effectively the character of Miyagi was based on Fumio Demura, the person, which has led to the documentary on Fumio Demura called The Real Miyagi and all this other stuff. But, you know, some of these other movies you mentioned, you know, Ip Man, Donnie Yen is as legitimate a martial artist and a tremendous martial artist really as you can find. And so I think that's kind of the common thread is, you know, to use a colloquialism, real recognizes real, you know, as martial artists, we recognize the legitimate martial artists regardless of plot, of some of maybe the hokey things. And when we hone in on that, and that can carry things through. I mean, the plot to The Karate Kid is pretty simple, and maybe it's one that resonates, but the acting isn't anything exceptional. The cinematography isn't anything that anyone's going to wouldn't have won any awards for, but it's a real martial arts movie that martial artists can relate to.
Yeah. It's a shame when you see people like Donnie Yen who get thrown in an American movie late too, and are so underutilized because he's so talented. Yeah. And then now I guess he's going to be in the next Star Wars movie. I'm not sure if it's Rogue One or the next episode.
No, it's Rogue One is what he's set for. And there have been a couple trailers that have come out and really not shown much of him. It's just
used to capture the Chinese market, which is terrible. If you're going to put someone in there of that caliber, utilize him. Just don't put him in there as the token guy, the token actor to attract a certain clientele.
Well, we'll see what happens. Yeah. And I mean, my hope is the same of a lot of martial artists of my generation that we get to see Donnie Yen wielding lightsabers.
Well, that would be really cool. I just hope they do a lot better than they did in Blade 2.
I think it would be hard to do worse than what they did with him in Blade 2.
You know.
So how about actors? If I had to pin you down for a favorite actor?
Michelle Yeoh is my favorite female actress. There's a couple for martial artists. There's a couple girls coming up, but she's my favorite. I'm friends with, so I have to mention, and actually I liked her too. Cynthia Rothrock. We're at a lot of events at the same time. And, I like Cynthia. I think she was underutilized. At the end of the day, you're at the whim of the scripts that come to you. And I don't think she was given the chance to really shine like she should. So those are my two favorite females. Males, I mean, it's Donnie Yen. I'm really beginning to like him more. You know, I mean, okay, so the top pack, it's always Jackie Chan, Jet Li, Donnie Yen, Sammo Hyun, and what's his name? Choi Li Fat? No, that's the art.
Chow Yun Fat.
And, you know, it's, I don't know if it's the actor or the character that I'm more with. Mm. I loved Chow Yun Fat in Bulletproof Monk.
Yeah.
I thought he was amazing. I liked him in the Replacement Killers. That was good too. But that was more, action. Then it was, I mean, he was great with Wahlberg in The Corruptor. So I like him a lot. Jet Li doesn't show his character's pretty predictable. he's had a diversity thing, but I think for acting, the craft of Fat is like the guy for me, as far as the best actor. Martial art wise, they've all had different things. I mean, I love Jackie Chan. I wish they'd give him a little more serious stuff. He's always the comedic. I mean, he's a funny guy to begin with, but I'd like to see him in something a little more serious, but he's so boxed in now.
Right. Right. He's got some stuff early and middle into his career as he was really starting to break out in Hong Kong before he was even really a household name here in the States that has a lot more serious stuff. We did a whole profile episode on him and talked a little bit about some of those earlier roles. And of course, his role in the newer Karate Kid movie, the 2010 version.
He was amazing in that. Oh my God. That was a nice blend. You know, I mean, he really took, you know, I know everyone was like, oh, it should have been the Kung Fu Kid. You know, it was the Karate Kid, you know, it's the same script. They just moved the country. Yeah. You know, I felt bad for the movie because they tried to throw racism at it. And it was like, oh, blacks against the Asians against the blacks. I'm like, no, you idiots. It's the new kid. It's the new kid in town. Get your story straight. Oh, yeah. I mean, but I actually liked that a lot. I mean, you know, it was rough because you knew it was coming. You know, I mean, the whole time you knew exactly how it was going to end. But I tell you what, I forgot, because I'm thinking of all these other movies. Jackie Chan did an amazing job in that movie.
Yeah, I think his performance was horrendously underrated.
Oh, yeah,
and I think part of it, you have to know him. You have to know what he usually does for it to really stand out.
Oh, yeah.
But that was my big takeaway from that film was how well
he was. Yeah.
So how about books? Are you at all a martial art book guy?
I'm a collector, but I'm dyslexic. I'm really bad at my dyslexia. Okay. So I got this collection that's highly underutilized, I'm looking at a bunch of them. There are a lot of Filipino martial arts. I've got a couple Kempo books here. I've got a couple Jeet Kune Do books. But there's nothing that really jumps out at me. You know, I mean, I've got... I'm dyslexic. And it can really mess with my head when I'm trying to do stuff. So, you know... The Art of War is nice because you can always read shorter snippets of it.
Mm.
You know, I don't have to read the whole thing. So, you know, sometimes I'm a genius when I'm reading and writing. And then other times I'm the caveman. And, you know, which is good because with the stick, you know, Mongo Smash. It works perfect with my art.
Right.
So, but I would probably say Art of War. And then... you know, my teacher's books, all the Praces stuff with both Remy and Ernesto Praces, they both had books out. But I would just source it just for some minor stuff real quick. And then, you know, like an encyclopedia, just kind of look at something, put it back on the shelf.
Sure. All right. Well, of course, you know, we know why you train. You know, it's your passion. It's your love for the arts. But I'm wondering if you have any goals. Is there anything that you're working towards in the future?
Yeah. It's not retirement because I don't plan on ever stopping.
Good.
but sooner or later, I'm going to stop. The battery's going to run out, and I'm not going to be able to do what I'm doing for one reason or another. So I run the World Modern Arnis Alliance. I was a senior student of the late Grandmaster Remy Prasis. This is the primary thing. Everything I do is based around this. And the other arts, it's like a Filipino Jeet Kune Do. So there's, it pulls from other systems. It's a very eclectic system. So this is why I've trained in all these other arts to look at some of our bases. Now, my goal is to set up the future so the generation after us can still keep the art going. So right now I look at other modern Arnis organizations and I don't know if it will continue past their generation. You know, right now I think that, you know, if we're talking about the US-based groups, we're the ones that have the best chance of having a generation or two after us. You know, right now I'm the face of this, but of the art, of the organization, but I now have a whole world-class team that are doing their own seminars now. I've got guys that are doing 15 seminars, 20 seminars a year. You know, and one of my guys up in Canada, Craig Mason, will be doing the first apprenticeship camp that I'm not teaching at. You know, because the goal is to have these guys run things, you know. My goal is not for my organization. When I pass on the art, the system, the org, or whatever, I really don't care if people continue under the banner of the World Modern Arnis Alliance. What's important to me is that the system continues forward. Having seen this time and time again with other systems and organizations, once the found, you know, the person who's in charge at the moment is the glue. When Remy was alive, we were all there. But he attracted a lot of people to his organization that may not get along with each other. Now, this isn't a bad thing. There's some people you like, and there's some people you don't. You know, just like some people like pasta and other people like steak. That's fine. And then after Professor passed on, a bunch of us went in different directions, our own ways. There's nothing wrong with that. So I don't have an unrealistic goal about the World Modern Arnis Alliance moving forward past my retirement, forced or otherwise. My goal, and I think we're doing pretty good right now, is that if something happened to me tomorrow, the art is going to continue through with our lineage. So that's my goal martial art wise right now. We're in the process of digitizing a lot of our material, having an online library so people can would be able to supplement their training, but not substitute personal training. So, you know, there's too many YouTube black belts out there. So this is an online reference to help you out. And, you know, so as you're coming up the ranks, oh, I forgot what that form was. What's that third move in the form? Oh, there it is. Okay. How do you do this disarming? Oh, that's what I'm missing. You know, I'm a visual guy, so I need to see things. I need to feel things. Reading in a book doesn't do it for me. Shh. And there's my young puppy once again barking at whatever's going on around here. But I need to see things. And you know, so this goal is an online reference to help us, you know. And you know, like I said, I don't have any problems with online courses, but there needs to be some physical interaction because some of this is about sensation, you know, where you're putting the pressure. You can't do that in a video. So right. those are some of our, you know, what we're doing right now. Hopefully in the fall, we'll have that up and running. Like I said, and the big thing right now is just preparing for my retirement, you know, and that's probably 50 years down the road, but you know, nonetheless, I still have to have people set up take the art. You know, right now, we're working on having Canada become more self-sufficient. I'm right on the Canadian border. You know, I want them to have me in because they want me there, not because they feel they have no choice. You know, I said, I've got a good team up in Canada that's doing well. So, you know, right now, if I was to just say, all right, I'm done, I'm not going to Canada anymore, you guys need to take care of yourself, they'd be in good hands.
Good. Good. And I think it's great that you're thinking of these things long in advance. I think a lot of charismatic school system owners don't give this idea much thought, that they just kind of figure everything will fall into place when they pass, if they pass. Well, when they pass, everyone passes, right?
Well, I don't know. I'm not going to, but you know,
you haven't yet. Yeah. I haven't yet. I mean, there's a chance.
Yeah.
Every you know, everyone that's alive today has not died.
Yeah. There you go.
So maybe one of us will make it. But all too often I've seen, and I'm going to guess you've seen it too, where after the passing of an especially charismatic grandmaster, things just fall apart. The politics, the jockeying for position, the power struggle, people, especially if there's money there, you know, and it just gets really messy. And for you to set up things so they can work better, I think is really admirable and says a lot for your love of the arts and the art that you are administering.
Well, you know, it happened with us when Remy passed on. It was a train wreck. You know, there are multiple organizations, but now let's look at the flip side of this. The first year he passed on, there was 150 some odd seminars taught. That was more modern arnis seminars that had ever been taught while he was alive per year. So, I mean, there's definitely good things with this. You know, when the head of the system passes on, it's a defining moment of that system. You know, will it fade away to obscurity or will it flourish? And, you know, a bunch of organizations popped up. You know, I had resigned from the main organization because I know a professor. I was with him when he got diagnosed with cancer. And we talked about a bunch of things. And, you know, he wanted to see me move forward with the art. I decided that the organization was going to hold me back. So when he resigned due to his physical conditions, I resigned from the organization as well, because I wasn't a member of the World or of the International Modernist Federation per se. I was a direct student of the late Grandmaster Remy Praises. And so, you know, I saw everything that happened. There's some pros to it as well as cons. Now with different people doing their own thing, they bring different things to the table, you know, and they can bring good things to the table. And, you know, and you might bring up a lot of innovation from different people because of different size, different strength, different backgrounds. And I think, like I said, you know, I think it's a good thing in some ways. You know, obviously there's some negativity out there, but, you know, and with that going on, I'm going to try to minimize what happens with my people when it's time for me no longer to be teaching. And like I said, you know, the big thing is to make the community self-sufficient. So, you know, we've gone from nothing when I left to the largest US-based modern arnis organization to date. And, you know, that's, I'm proud of that. And I feel confident that when it's time for me to stop teaching, there'll be others in place to continue the art, not necessarily the organization.
That's great. So if people want to learn more, if they want to learn more about your organization or the seminars or anything under your umbrella, where would they go for that information?
Well, they could go to datuhartman.com. They can also go to wmarnis.com. So if you look up Datu Hartman, you'll find me. If you Google World Modern Arnis Alliance, you'll find the organization. And then if you're in the Metro Buffalo, New York area, I run Horizon Martial Arts, horizonma.com. So these are the three ways to get a hold of me. You know, if you can't get a hold of me, it's because you're not trying. We've had people, oh, I can never get a hold of Datu. That's funny. Every time I call, he picks up the phone. So I used to have my phone forwarded to my cell. Obviously, if I'm out of the country, it's pretty hard. But if you leave a voice message, I'll get you.
Sure. And I can attest it was not very hard to get a hold of you.
Yeah.
So, well, this has been great. Any parting words of wisdom for everyone listening?
So many things. Well, I think what we do is easy as martial arts. I think sometimes it's not hard. We just make it complicated. So what I would tell people is, you know, continue your training. Try to look at the root of what you're doing. Try to figure out what the basic formula is and experiment. As long as it's safe for you and your training partner, no, don't let it hold you back. Realize that a system is only good as the people doing it. And just because they're doing someone else is doing something different doesn't mean it's wrong. It's just a different taste. So there is no one style better than another. Unless you're training with me, then we're the best. And that was a joke just in case people didn't get my full contact sense of humor. But, I think those are probably the things I would tell people coming up, you know, train, you know, and, you know, don't be afraid to experiment and, you know, try the Marshall Buffet out there, go visit seminars and stuff like that.
Thank you for listening to episode 102 of Whistlekick Martial Arts Radio, and thank you to Datu Hartman. Over at whistlekickmartialartsradio.com, you can find links to Datu Hartman's social media accounts, his school, association, some photos, and a video for the Stick Fighting World Combat League we discussed. If you like the show, be sure you're subscribing or using one of our free apps. They're available on both iOS and Android. For those of you kind enough to leave us a review, remember, we randomly check out the different podcast review sites, and if we find your review mentioned on the air, be sure to email us for your free pack of Whistlekick stuff, including a t-shirt and some other great things. We haven't had any reviews for a couple weeks, so here's an easy way for you to get a free shirt. If you know someone that would be a great interview for the show, please fill out the form at whistlekickmartialartsradio.com. Or if you want to shoot us a message with a suggestion for a Thursday show topic or just some other feedback, there's a place to do that as well. You can follow us on social media. We're on Facebook, Twitter, Pinterest, YouTube, and Instagram. And our username is always Whistlekick. Remember the products you can find at whistlekick.com or on Amazon, like those comfortable sweatshirts. If you're a school owner or a team coach, check out our wholesale site, wholesale.whistlekick.com. It's a great discounted program over there that you should be taking advantage of. We'll be back soon, but until next time, train hard, smile, and have a great day.